Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sisters and brothers, today I wish you happy good morning or afternoon or evening, wherever you are. Today we are going to talk about a very difficult subject. This was a request came to me last week from a young lady from Canada. Her name is Amina. She wrote to me and telling me, Dr. Hani, or not, I mean, Brother Hani, just talk about women. For the last week, I was very, very busy trying to collect data about the contribution of Muslim women to civilization, or to Islam, or to science, or to technology, or to theology. It's very difficult. I have sleepless nights for the last 5-6 days to try to justify the immense role of our sisters, mothers, aunties, grandma, of their contribution to humanity. But before we started that, let me start with saying two great women lived in two different centuries. One of them built a great society around a well called Zamzam in Mecca, Lady Hajar alayhi salam. The second one, which did the same in 16th century, was a woman called Buktu in West Africa, in Mali, who built a well. In the 16th century, around this well, a village was built, then become a crossroad of trade between West Africa and the rest of the North African countries in the East. Then after that, this well became the center of civilization in West Africa. A role of women without actually looking back at their contribution to Islam or to humanity as well. Before we start talking about role of women in Islam, let me tell you the oldest 4 or 5 universities on earth. First one was Zaytuna in Tunisia, okay, built in a mosque, out of a mosque in 737, okay, which is 120 Hijri year. Second one was in Baghdad, called Bayt al-Hikma, the House of Wisdom, built at the time of Abbasi dynasty, Harun Rashid, Al-Ma'mun, and others. Then it was destroyed totally by the Mughal when they invaded Baghdad in the 13th century, 1258. Then the University of Qarawiyyin, built by somebody called Fatima Al-Fahriya. She was from Tunisia, but she traveled to live in Fas. And this university was built in Fas at that time in 859 9th century and 245 Hijri. It was the first structured institution, okay, giving degrees and what you call emeritus status to the professor there. Then Al-Azhar was built in Cairo in the 10th century, 970, by the Fatimite state, Al-Mu'izz al-Din al-Fatimi. Then Dar al-Hikmah again in Egypt, built in 1004, which is 395 Hijri, also by the Fatimite state. And inside this university, which is Dar al-Hikmah, which is different from Bayt al-Hikmah in Baghdad, there was 1.6 million book and document. 6,500 of them were in mathematics and mathematics-related subject, and 18,000 of them were actually in philosophy. When we look at this university or in Baghdad, in Zaytuna, in Fas, in Cairo. Renaissance. Role of woman start there and here and here and there. Now our universities that we are building become privatized, become commercial. All these universities either was built by individual like Fatima al-Fahriya in Fas or built by the state. So the state responsibility is to sponsor education, to enable the civilian to achieve their potential in different subjects, theology, science, history, etc. This is when we talk about the universities. Let us look about women in the first century of Islam. Nobody can deny a great scholar of Islam called Aisha, the wife of the Prophet ﷺ, who narrated more than 2,200 hadith and listened to her more than 299 sahabi. And she was always teaching them, male and female, as a scholar from day one. And she was telling them, don't be shy to ask difficult questions. Your mother, which is Aisha, can respond to this difficult question. Number one was Aisha in the first century. Number two, if we look there, the wives of the Prophet ﷺ. There's another one called Nusaybah bint Ka'b. Of course, Nusaybah bint Ka'b was another Sahabiyya, companion of the Prophet ﷺ. She witnessed four battlefields. Uhud, and the other ones. The last one was them against Musaylamah al-Kazzab. Actually, she lost her son there, was killed by Musaylamah al-Kazzab, but she was actually one of the people who was narrating hadith. Umm Salama was narrating hadith. Okay. Hafsa bint Umar bin Khattab was narrating hadith, radiallahu anha. Okay. Zainab bint Jahsh was narrating hadith. Asma bint Abu Bakr was narrating hadith. And so on. All those Ummahat al-Mu'mineen were scholars. And on their authority, we took the hadith from them. So this was the beginning. And we don't want to deny this strong start of the role of women in Islam. The greatest lobbyist in Islam at day one was Mother Khadija. Nobody should ever question the great role of Mother Khadija as a lobbyist, as a supporter, as a shadowing the Prophet ﷺ, as a visionary for Prophet ﷺ and for Islam as a religion from day one, from the birth of Islam at that time. So don't listen to such people who look women in and treat them like objects or subjects. Some other names in the first century was Umm Darda al-Sughra, which we call it Sughra, yani the second Umm Darda. There's two Umm Darda. Abu Darda was married to two women, Umm Darda al-Kubra and Umm Darda al-Sughra. Umm Darda al-Sughra was tabi'i, did not see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she died at the age at the 80 Hijri year. She was teaching at the Umayyah Mosque in Damascus, where quite often the Caliph Abdul Malik ibn Marwan used to go and listen to her teaching. She was a teacher in a mosque, and she died on the year 80 Hijri at that time. And she was the second wife of Abu Darda, the companion of the Prophet ﷺ. Another woman called Amra bint Abd al-Rahman al-Ansariya, al-Bukhari and other great scholars narrated hadith that she mentioned. She died on the year 106 Hijri, and she was in Medina teaching, narrating the hadith of the Prophet, guiding people, guiding on the first end of the first century and the beginning of the second century. Okay? I mentioned Fatima al-Fahriya before. Al-Harrani, Zainab bint Makki al-Harrani, but this is later on. But when we look at here, see, all those great ladies from the first century were actually teaching, narrating, writing, and learning. Teaching, narrating, writing, and learning. And under authority, a lot of great scholars like Abu al-Bukhari, Tirmidhi, al-Nasa'i, Muslim, and others were actually referring to their teaching and to their narration. Okay, second one, please. Second Hijri, Sayyidina Nafisa. You see Sayyidina Nafisa, the Bint al-Hassan, after the conflict happened in Medina, actually, she was Sayyidina Nafisa was actually died in the second century, and she traveled. She immigrated to Cairo, to Egypt, because there was a political conflict in Medina about Ahlul Bayt, and in Cairo, she had an Islamic circle in the mosque twice a week. Twice a week. Where one of the scholars such as Imam al-Shafi'i used to attend the circle and to discuss with her the depth of Islamic knowledge subject. And she, her nickname was Nafisa al-Ilm, Nafisa of knowledge. Nafisa of knowledge. This was in the second Hijri year. The second Hijri century. Okay. This was many of them. Lady Rabah al-Adawiyya died in the 180. This one, okay. And she was a learned scholar and reciters and Sufiya, okay, and so on. Fatima bint Malik ibn Anas, Imam Malik, okay, and Imam Sa'id Ibn al-Musayyab. Let me explain to you something about this girl, the daughter of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, radiallahu anhu, tabi'i. Her father was one of the great scholars of Islam at the time in fiqh, theology, history, hadith, and so on, so on, so. And she was very well brought up. And she was proposed by the Khalifa from the Umayyad to his son. Okay? Her father refused. And the father had in his circle one of his students. One of his students. Okay? His name was Ibn Abi Wada'a. And he came one day late to the circle and was a little bit upset. Imam Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab told him, "What's wrong with you?" He said, "I just married my wife." He said, "Do you want to marry someone?" He said, "Yes, but I don't have any money to be able to marry." He said, "How much you have?" He said, "I got 2 dirham. Something very, very, very minimum." Said, "Okay, I'm going to let you to marry my daughter." Said, "What? My daughter? You're going to marry my daughter?" Then the man went to his home in a shocking state. How on earth am I going to prepare dowry? How on earth am I going to prepare my house? How? All this big house. Then an hour later on, somebody came and knocked the door. And the man said, "Who's at the door?" He said, "I am Sa'id." The man never thought that this was Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, radiallahu anhu. He said, which is Sa'id? He said, Sa'id ibn Musayyib. He said, oh my God. He thought that Sa'id ibn Musayyib is coming to change his mind about letting him to marry his daughter. He said, my son, I married you to my daughter, and since you got married here officially, I cannot let you to sleep as a bachelor in your house tonight. This is your wife. Come on, my daughter. And she came to his house. And Sa'id ibn Musayyib said, okay, my son, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The son was shocked. The husband was shocked, and they got up to the roof of the house, calling all the neighbor. Ummu fulan, ummu fulan, oh mother of what, mother of what. The neighbor says, what's wrong with you? Said, Sa'id ibn Musayyib brought his daughter to me, and she's my wife. I don't have anything at home. Everybody was trying to do something to entertain this new wife coming to him, to the house. You know what happened? Oh, his mother came and told him, my son, never touch your daughter, your wife, till I prepare her for you for 3 days. Then he, alhamdulillah, married her. Then he was locked in next day or after married. He told her, can I go to listen to your father in his circle? Said, no. Sit here. Sit at home. I will teach you what my father is going to teach you in the mosque. And he was in the house for a month. Not as a honeymoon. The honey and the moon, or the moon and the honey. No. She was teaching her husband, who was a student of her father. It's the quality of the daughter of Sa'id ibn Musayyib. Then when he came out after a month, not in a honeymoon, not a lovely, bubbly, ugly, or this kind of thing, oh, we're going to go to the honeymoon, we're going to Paris, we're going to Rome, we're going, wishy, 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 wishy. Yes, yaki, baki, aki, no. Then when his father asked about him and his marriage, he said, I have a real wife that I'm living. Another one like this was in Turkestan. Her name was actually Fatima Samarkandiya, Fatima Samarkandi, in the 6th century. Exactly the same. Exactly the same. Okay. She was proposed by the Muslim kings from the Arab background and from the non-Arab background, but her father refused to marry her to any one of them. And you know what was her dowry? Sisters and brothers, okay? To one of his students, his name was Alaeddin al-Kasani. What was the dowry? Is her father tested him. In a book was written called Tuhfat al-Fuqa, The Wonder of the Scholars. And when her husband passed the test, he told her, now you can marry my daughter. Great ladies, great civilization, great nation. Great nation, great ummah. Not being governed by fiqh, or a culture which never was a culture of Islam from day one. From the time of Khadija, from the time of Aisha, radiallahu anhum, from the time of Asma, and all ummahat al-Muslimin. Never was that culture of the Muslims or the culture of or the teaching of Islam. Another woman at the first, her name is Amra Al-Ansariya. She was from Medina as well. And she was one of the narrator of hadith that Al-Bukhari and other scholars took from her. In Damascus, so when you look at the Islamic civilization, or I don't like to call it Islamic, but actually at that time, call it whatever you want to call it, we found there's focal points of enlightenment, of civilization, from Fas to Kairouan, to Cairo, to Alexandria, to Damascus, to Baghdad, to Naisabur, to Khurasan, to Mecca, to Medina, okay, to Kufa, to Basra, everywhere. The Ummah was giving the freedom of speech and liberty of movement. Exchange of knowledge. Learning. Woman teaching men, men teaching women. Our culture now has nothing to do, has nothing to do at all with the great teachers of Islam at that time. Aisha al-Harraniya died in year 647 Hijri, which is 7th century, and she was teaching also in the Umayya Mosque. You know what was her job? She was, what do you call, tailor. So she was not sitting in the mosque teaching by getting a salary from the Khalifa or others. Then Al-Arab bint Abd al-Rahman ibn Umar ibn al-Husayn, is known as bint al-Khayzurani. She was responsible for something called Rubat al-Haramain in Mecca. Another woman from Mecca, another woman from Medina. Today we celebrate the woman become able to drive a car. I'm talking about women were able to drive Ummah, to drive civilization, to build the Renaissance, to create strong leadership, to establish the principles of value of life, to build morality, to build strong culture, to build your identity, to build our credibility. Who are the women in Islam? Our mother is Khadija, Aisha, Fatima, alayhi salam, Hafsa, Maryam, alayhi salam, Hajar, alayhi salam. These are our mothers. Not the hukubuku, which we see them on television, with different styles. Go back. My advice to myself and every one of you. In less than 1 week, I was shocked by the amount of knowledge about the contribution of our women to humanity. From the first Hijri year, at the time where Europe was in the Dark Ages, America did not exist. Okay, other countries did not exist. And your woman, our mothers, our sisters were leading humanity, building universities, teaching, guiding, bringing up, even taking political decisions, even become ambassadors. I'm not going to talk about the great Renaissance in Andalusia, North Africa, or others. No, because I am not historian. Because I am not theologian, because I am not a scholar. I am somebody who is giving a wake-up call. Giving a wake-up call. Wakey-wakey. This is not our culture. This is not our fiqh. This is not the way we understand Islam. This is not the way that Islam has spread or has built great civilization on earth up till now. If you want to build another civilization, if you want to create this kind of renaissance, know your history. Know who is your stars, who is your icons, who is your legend. Read it. Don't let anybody to stop between you and your history, between you and your value, between you and your morality, between you and the legend that who led us to be here, standing on our feet. We're very, very proud of them, so we have to imitate what they have been doing. A lot of women in Mecca and Medina were teachers. Karima al-Mirwaziya, it is lived from 363 to 463 Hijri. And she had Islamic circles in Mecca. teaching everyone. Even Khatib al-Baghdadi used to come and learn and listen to her. Okay, another one also from Baghdad, Shahda bint Ahmad ibn al-Ibri, Ibri in Arabic, which is a needle, and her father, this was her father's profession. She was teaching as well. She was muhaddisa, scholar, narrating hadith, and she was actually making calligraphy. And she built a place called Dar Sajja, yeah, the house of Sajja, when she was receiving hundreds and hundreds of young men and women to learn the knowledge of Islam and other things. Okay? Let me take you back quickly before we end. Great scholars, فين great scholars هم الرجال ما عملتاش ده. Great scholars learned or took hadith from women. First one of them was الإمام علي رضي الله عنه عليه السلام. He took hadith from Maymuna bint Saad, which was a slave girl, African slave girl. الإمام مالك بن أنس نفسه himself took from عائشة بنت أبي وقاص الأنصارية. الإمام أحمد بن حنبل okay took from السيدة نفيسة رضي الله عنها. الإمام الزهري who lived between 58 هجري and 124 هجري took from 5 women the hadith. الإمام السلفي as well took. الإمام ابن عساكر as well okay. الإمام ابن الجوزي took from 3 female شيخ. الإمام أبو سعد السمعاني took nearly from 69 women when narrating hadith. Listen to them. الإمام المنذري took from 20 female شيخ. Okay. الإمام الذهبي took from الإمام الذهبي was traveling from Jerusalem to Cairo to listen to somebody called what? Her name is Umm Sayyida bint Musa المارانية المصرية. Unfortunately, on the way to her, she died. And he was regretting that he did not meet such a woman before she died. الإمام السيوطي took from about 43 female sheikh, according to the letter of hadith, and so on, and so on, and so on, and so on. And these are the scholars at these different centuries of your civilization or civilization. My conclusion today, because I don't want you to stay more than half an hour, we have great names, we have legends. Stand up for them. Look up for their contribution. Male and female, from Andalusia, Moroccan woman in the good old days contributed heavily, heavily to the humanitarian civilization globally, not only Islamic civilization. Heavily. North African woman, heavily. Egyptian woman, heavily. Syrian woman, heavily. Woman from Iraq, woman from Balkh, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and others, heavily to this. We have been infested by a culture, which is not our culture, a fiqh, which is not our fiqh, and narrow-mindedness, which was not there at the golden era of our life, when we live together, have free movement, free speeches going from one place to another place. So if you woman want to stand up for your right, you have to stand up on a firm foundation called knowledge, called history, called learning, called asking for your rights, called not to be shut up by some ignorant parrots. You know parrots? The people who bam 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 without hum 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 hum. They do not understand what they are reciting because it does not go to the back of their mind to enable them to understand it in its context, then to comprehend it, then to enable them to produce the opinion. They are the repeaters. I don't know what to call them. Two weeks ago, we talked about the hashtag scholars. Today, we talk about the parrots. The difference between a reciter and alim. Most of what we have nowadays in Europe, for God's sake, there are mosques that not allow women to come to pray during the 5-time prayer a day. And we are in the middle of Europe. Wake up. Hey, ask for your right and tell them this is not the Islam that the Prophet ﷺ, who said, do not prevent the female slave of Allah from coming to where? To the house of Allah. This mosque is not your house. It's not the house of your tribe. It's not the house of your jama'ah. It's not the house of your neighborhood. Even if you build it, it is the house of Allah, which allows men, women, and children to come and learn. Otherwise, we leave an ignorant woman at home, ignorant girl at home, and then when they go astray, we curse them. Why? We should curse ourselves because we do not allow them to be taught as much as we learn from the mosque. So, seriousness is to stand up for your right, but know your history. Definitely know your right history and see how the contribution of women at the good old days built or cemented and improved and spread this civilization, which humanity is still enjoying itself from its fruits. I didn't want to talk today about science, technology, and the other. No. I'm just telling you, woman scholar. Now through Google, through, what is the other one? Wikipedia and others and others and others and others. Go and be like any one of these great women. Book 2, Beldawel, in West Africa, became a center of civilization. This lady, may Allah be pleased with her. No different from Zamzam in Mecca, which was built 4,000 or 5,000 years before that. Built around Zamzam, the great Renaissance at that area. And each and everyone, many contribution. But you know what? We are ignorant. We are ignorant of our history. That was sure any ignorant can lead the ignorant. If we don't know the history, we don't know the rights, our rights, we don't know the knowledge, anybody can lead us. Anybody can say anything. And there's a lot of locusts on television, on Facebook, and the Prophet ﷺ called them Ruwai Bidat, the ignorant individual who give fatwa without knowledge. Mosques do not allow women to come to pray in the middle of Paris or London or New York. Wow. And they told them, oh, you come after 5 o'clock. You come at in the weekend. And even I was in one of the Arab countries on Friday. You know what they said, wrote in the mosque? Sisters, you're not allowed to come to the mosque today because it's full. What is this? Do you want me to What is this? Go back to the original teaching to be able to start another civilization. Next week, inshallah, we'll be talking about Renaissance. Big challenge. I'll brief about you about it, maybe Saturday or Sunday. But next week about Renaissance. Okay, Saturday is Ashura. I'm congratulating you with Ashura. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. We fast Ashura day. You can fast the 9th, the 10th, or the 10th and the 11th, or the 9th and 10th and the 11th, or the 10th itself. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.